Hello and welcome to The Wire. I am Karnika Kohli, and today with me there's Delhi-based journalist Neha Dixit, and we're going to be discussing the use of NSA by the Adityanath government in Uttar Pradesh. In March this year, Adityanath claimed that not even a single incident of communal violence has taken place in UP since he took over. Well, that claim was fact-checked by the Home Ministry in the parliament itself. UP continues to be on the top of list of the states in terms of number of incidents of communal violence. In 2017 alone, 44 people were killed while 540 were injured. In 2016, it was much less, 29 people were killed and 490 were injured. In 2015, it was even less, 22 people were killed while 410 were injured. In August recently, the chief minister claimed that law and order in UP was best in the state has seen in the last 15 years. Well, turns out that claim is also false. So today we have Neha Dixit with us. She's going to help us debunk that claim and show us some sort of like take us beyond the headlines and show what really is happening in UP. So Neha, over the last 1 year, especially in 2017, UP government has invoked the National Security Act against 160 people. And they have conducted some 1,200 police encounters in 10 months alone. This is something that usually is used by the UP government to brag. And then a lot of critics, though, however, say that this how Adityanath has turned Uttar Pradesh into a police Raj because of his lack of administrative experience. So what's the ground reality since you've been covering this for a while now?
Thanks, Kanika, for doing this. One has to really understand that this claim about controlling law and order, that was also a issue that they raised during the 2017 assembly elections campaign. BJP used that, saying that during the SP government it was actually Gunda Raj in UP. But since they have come into power, there are two, three things that one really needs to understand, that the way in a very opaque manner the encounters, like you mentioned, have been conducted, which is almost like 4 encounters per day. And when we last reported, there were 42 people who've been killed. Now that number has moved to 67. So 67 people have been killed. And on the basis of some petty charges like theft or stealing 5,000 rupees or something of that sort. Similarly, in the cases of NSA, now one has to understand how NSA has been used in the last 1 year. Now the figures that we are quoting, 160 people arrested under National Security Act by UP government, they were released in January 2018 this year. That number, rough estimate, is 200 now. So 200 people are behind bars. We have to understand what NSA is, in the sense that we all know that Bhim Army leader Chandrasekhar Azad, he's been in Saharanpur jail since November last year. Under the National Security Act. National Security Act is an act which is known as no vakil, no appeal, no daleel. Because once you are charged under that, what happens is that you cannot have a legal counsel to represent you, and it is the state-appointed advisory board, which does not even have judicial officers but revenue officers, who decide whether you are a threat to national security or not. So that is really problematic, because say all of us know about Chandrasekhar because he's a political figure and he's been representing the Dalit agitation on the ground, but these other 160 to 200 people who've been arrested are all working class people, mostly Muslims and Dalits. So how are they going to get representation? And also, again, if you're charged with NSA, you can be behind bars for almost a year, which means the family starts suffering.
Yeah. So Neha has been reporting for the last 2 months on this story, which is now live on our website, thewire.in. You can go check it out. So Neha interviewed 15 families of people who have been detained under NSA. So I was going through your report, and one thing that kind of like stands out is that in most of these cases, there have been allegations, and you can see clear, involvement of Hindu groups also. Like there's Hindu Yuva Bahini, which was led by the UP chief minister at one point of time. There's ABVP, which is BJP student youth wing, student wing. Those people were also part of these incidents. Like they also incited a lot of those, and there was a lot of instigation on their part also. But in the end, it's always the Muslims who end up getting arrested. So could you share some examples of such incidents?
So I'll just break it down into 4 parts, in the sense that I went to Bahraich, Barabanki, Azamgarh and Kanpur. Now, what has happened in most of these cases is, for example, let's start with the Kanpur case. Last year, there was a clash of dates for Muharram and Durga Idol immersion. So, the local intelligence units across the state had informed Adityanath government that there is a possibility of that and they should control. But like we know, like Yogi Adityanath, just now when there was this whole ruckus created by Kavadiyas on the road, he said ki ye shav yatra nahi hai, ye shav yatra hai, which means that people are free to go and celebrate in whatever way. So in Kanpur, a clash was created, a communal clash was created, and the people from outside who came were from the Hindu Samaj Party. Now one has to know that Hindu Samaj Party is an offshoot of Akhil Bharatiya Hindu Mahasabha. And the person heading it in UP is Kamlesh Tiwari, who has earlier been arrested for making derogatory remarks about Prophet Muhammad. He's been arrested several times over for trying to instigate the Ram Janmabhoomi again. He's led several people to the site in Ayodhya to create a ruckus. So these people are actively involved. Similarly, the Hindu Yuva Vaini people are actively involved. So a place called Barabanki, which is very close to Lucknow, it's known for a Sufi shrine called Deva Sharif. So Deva Sharif was established by a Sufi saint called Waris Shah Ali, and he was known for letting his followers practice any religion. So all of us, I come from UP, so many of us have grown up going to the shrine. Suddenly when the UP government came into power, they started categorizing it as a Muslim shrine and started saying, Yogi Adityanath made a statement saying, Deva mein bijli hai, Mahadeva mein nahi, which is Mahadeva is another temple. Mahadeva temple also has a syncretic culture because most of the shops owned outside the mandir for the prasad and for the offerings are owned by Muslims. So Hindu Yuva Vaini people came there again and started instigating this kind of clash. Now the problem in most of these are two examples, and then comes Behraich and Azamgarh. But the problem is that most of these complaints, FIRs that have been filed by the police in these cases have been filed by Hindu Yuva Vaini and Hindu Samaj Party people and not the police. In such cases of communal clashes, the police is bound to file an independent FIR, which hasn't happened. So most of the witnesses, most of the complainants are people from the Hindu nationalist groups. And in return, the people who are arrested are all Muslims. Even when there have been several there have been witnesses and evidence on the ground to suggest that people from the Hindu nationalist groups were also equally involved. So there is a clear kind of sectarian motivation here.
So I do want to come back to discuss the role that the local police is playing, but I'd like to point something out for our viewers. Even though BJP won the general assembly elections and the local general and assembly elections comfortably, party's representation in civic body is not great. In December 2017, during civic polls, it only received 29% of the vote. There seems to be a pattern here, correct me if I'm wrong. So communal tensions are instigated by communal tensions are instigated before elections or in places where there seems to be a Muslim or Dalit majority, right? Or places where they're coexisting and which won't traditionally be considered BJP's vote bank, yeah. Right? Yeah.
So, for example, like you mentioned elections, the Kanpur incident happened just 2 months before the municipal body elections. So, in the municipal body elections, this person, particular person, Hakim, was very well known. He's been arrested under NSA. He was quite known in his community in Juhi Parampurwa, this place where this violence was instigated, to participate in both Hindu and Muslim events in the area. And he was planning to contest in those Kanpur Nagar Nigam elections. And then once this happened, this kind of communal clash was created. So now Parampurwa again has a mixed population of Dalits and Muslims, and they've always coexisted. After the Hindu Yuva Vaini and Hindu Samaj people came that day, on the day of the procession of the Muharram and Durga immersion, a tension was created. Specifically, Muslim houses were targeted and the tent houses were targeted and burnt, and not the other ones. And after that, 2 months later, the Parsi candidate from the Dalit community, who was representing BJP, won the elections. So there is a clear electoral angle. Yeah.
just since because you just mentioned the instance of where the tent houses were burned, I'd like to point out the owner of the tent house, whose house as well as whose shop was burnt and his family has been displaced, was actually arrested by the police, and NSA was invoked against him instead of the people who actually did that. One thing that I noticed in most of the families that you interviewed, the person who has been arrested is usually the sole bread owner, right? So I feel like by just invoking NSA invariably, the state is effectively not only crippling the family's finances, but also kind of making sure that, you know, the Muslim community in this particular case, they already belong to poor families. Like all of these men who have been arrested, they belong to poor families. Some of them don't even make like 150 rupees in a day. So these people do, they are treated like second class citizens, and because of this, and now that they're in jail and their families are displaced, so they do end up in that same, the narrative basically continues.
See, you're right in the sense that there are two, three things. One is that if you arrest such a large number of people from one community under National Security Act, later on you can go on and say people from this community are a threat to national security. So that is the idea, and one cannot ignore the fact that this is before the 2019 elections, just a few months before the 2019 elections. Also, the kind of family that you're talking about, of course, there is a kind of socio-economic marginalization anyway within the institution of the state. And now, I'll in Bahrait, for example, one of the people at whose house had gone to, he was used to work as a rickshaw puller in Delhi, and he used to earn 200-300 rupees a day, and every 3 months he would go back to Bahrait to his family. The day I went there for reporting, there was a mud house and a thatched roof which was broken, and this woman, his wife, had 6 children, and there was a handi on a chulha on a mud stove, and they had 6 potatoes boiling with turmeric and salt. And that is all they had for dinner. So this is, I'm giving this example because this is the situation of the people who have been shown as a threat to national security. That is their condition. And then lawyers are also fleecing them by saying that you give us money. But the point is that nobody knows the law. You know that lawyers directly cannot intervene in this kind of a situation. Similarly, in a Kanpur, with a family in Kanpur, since one of the girl's father has been arrested, that girl had to face a lot of stigma in the school, including kind of communal baths, which were her classmates started saying that, oh, all Muslims are criminals and all. And she had to actually drop out of school, and she lost an entire year of academics because of this kind of situation. So it is not just putting this whole breadwinner behind the bars, but also giving out this message that it's okay to be sectarian and communal in nature and throw barbs in this manner.
Yeah, it's kind of great actually that you focus so much on the kind of impact there is on the families emotionally and mentally also. But historically, we have seen that it's actually Western UP which has been a hub of communal violence, right? But you focus mostly on Eastern UP. Do you think there's a change in, you know, how things have happened in Western UP? Have the number of incidents gone up, gone down? Are they different in nature?
See, I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say that things have changed, because if you look at the UP encounter stories that I had done, all the 14 people I had met, the families of 14 people who had been killed, were from Western UP. In Eastern UP, because they are, like I said, they are specifically going to areas where there has been the Dalit-Muslim unity or a kind of communal harmony in place, they are going and creating tensions there. There have been NSA cases in Western UP as well, but most of these cases are in those incidents where people have been charged of cow smuggling or cow slaughter. So the nature is completely different from how here there is a pattern where they're trying to create communal clashes. One thing more that I wanted to add before I forget is that, like Chandrasekhar's case, the Bhim Army leader's case, the moment he was granted bail from the Sessions Court, the next day he was charged with NSA. In all these 15 cases that I've met, this is the same pattern. And that is what is problematic, because, see, the Session Court is also using the same FIRs and the same arguments and giving them a chance by going and fighting it out in the court by giving them providing them with bail. But what the police is doing, because the police is unprepared prepared to challenge that? They're imposing this kind of law against them to not do their homework enough and just charge them and put them behind bars. So that is also a violation of our fundamental right. When the court is giving you bail, then why is the police slapping NSA cases in such a high number is unprecedented in UP?
It kind of seems like everything's sort of going against them, considering one, they come from poor family, so they don't have enough money to get proper representation in court. And then because the NSA is invoked, so they don't get enough information on why they have been arrested, for how long they're going to be there. I remember one of the instances where the family hasn't seen the person who was arrested, like his wife and his kids haven't seen him for months. So that must also have like some sort of like really messed up impact, right, on the family and the kids especially, because and there's so many examples you gave of how kids had to leave school to start working because they can't earn. So there's really no one looking after them, not even the state, right?
Of course, the state, there's no point, only because the people, like I said, in NSA, so there's a document, there's a report by the South Asian Human Rights Documentation Center, which has shown that since NSA was passed in the 1980s, from that point till now, most of the time NSA has been used against people who are poor and socioeconomically marginalized. And that is where the problem is, because if you do not get representation, legal representation under this act, which means that somebody who's illiterate or somebody who is not very familiar with the technicalities, how do they present their case in front of the advisory board? And that is a problem. The other observation that this report made was that most of the time the advisory boards are reluctant to go against the state, and this case, by state I mean the police that has slapped NSA. So most of the time advisory boards do not nullify NSA or say that it's no longer required and they can come out.
So I'm going to go back a little on the areas where there's Muslim and Dalit majority. So a lot of people do, like when these stories come out, a lot of people do say that this is not new, right? These instances, and but there have been examples of people coexisting, and there have been examples of, you know, Muslim population participating in Hindu events, Hindu festivals, and vice versa. Could you share some examples of how that has changed? Like, are there attempts being made to instigate some sort of like, you know, violence or some sort of like not a positive discourse between these two communities? Has it increased since the BJP took over, or is basically the same thing?
See, I gave you this example of Deva Sharif. Okay, now the problem is that if you start categorizing shrines, Sufi shrines, which have been known to have followers from across the country as Muslims, and if you start attacking Muslim shop owners outside a temple who've been there for 200 years, then there is clearly a pattern. For example, like I said, in Barabanki, there is this person who likes to be called as Chota Yogi, and he's modeling himself after the chief minister of UP, and he's also trying to start a campaign increasingly that all the mosques shouldn't have loudspeakers, the Muslim shop owners outside the Hindu temple should go. So it's largely trying to mess around with the syncretic culture that has always existed and trying to polarize people. There's a clear agenda here, and like I also said, that in most of these cases, if there has been a clash, why are people from the other side not arrested? Why are people from one community only arrested? And that is what somebody needs to seriously look at. Some court, some judicial body has to take cognizance of this high number misuse of this law.
One thing that's very clear is that this sort of like communal polarization and all that has economic implications also, right, to certain communities and all that, and that's something I feel is not talked about enough. Coming back to the role that the local police is playing, because I feel like especially in small districts, they are the biggest form of authority that people can go to, and there are so many instances that you've reported where police, people have claimed that police has taken bribe but still not help people, and they continuously, and these people who cannot afford, who are barely making a living and all of that. So what kind of role do you think the police has played, and what can be changed? Has it gone like from bad to worse? Because UP has a history, UP doesn't exactly known for, you know, great infrastructure in that sense.
See, it has gone to worse in the sense that Of course, the law and order has always been a problem in UP. But this is the first, I mean, I wouldn't say first time, but this is one of those times when the police has out and out gone and acted against certain marginalized communities. This includes Dalits. If you look at the Shabirpur violence in Saharanpur last year, which where the Thakurs were attacking the Dalits in Shabirpur and the police was not at all there to stop it. In these cases where local intelligence units have informed the police that there is a possibility of the VHP people going and creating a ruckus, but they have not acted on it, and then specifically targeting certain kind of people for encounters, for imprisonment, for NSA, we are no one to judge, but there has to be a proper investigation on this. Even in the encounters, there has to be a proper investigation to find out whether they were fake or whether they were real. We are not casting aspersions, but all the patterns that we see in the NSA cases or in the encounter cases need serious investigation, and nobody is taking cognizance of that. In fact, the National Human Rights Commission has issued several notices. In the first 10 months of UP government, the NHRC issued 11 notices to the UP government, and till date, not one has been responded to. What does it say that they don't care about human rights?
Clearly. I feel you've raised some really important questions, and I really hope that the mainstream media also picks up the story and there's a certain amount of follow-up so that people who are responsible can be held accountable. I would like to remind our viewers that good journalism costs money, and the wire runs on reader donations, so do consider supporting us so that we can carry some more stories like this. Thanks for watching us today.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.